أسطورنا القرآن وديننا الإسلام، أركانه الجليلة دعائم الفضيلة، ويا الشهادتان كعيدة الإيمان، والصوم والصلاة وحج والزكاة. Our guide is the Quran, our religion is Islam.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. الحمد لله على نعمة الإسلام وكفى بها نعمة. الحمد لله على منة الولاية وكفى بها منة. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا النبي المؤيد والرسول المسدد والمصطفى الأمجد والمحمود الأحمد حبيبي إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد. صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين، سفن النجاة الأعلام، من ركب سفينتهم نجا ومن تخلف عنها هلك وغرق. ثم أما بعد، respected elders, brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. كمچو هباري. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this holy month of Ramadan an opening and a prelude to success, salvation, happiness and the unity of Muslims worldwide. My greetings to all of you on the eve and the night of the holy month of Ramadan. It is good to be back home and to be with the community after a long absence of 11 years. It is really humbling to be called into such a jamaat. And I hope that inshallah over the course of these 15 nights, we will be able to explore whatever we are able to explore in regard to how we can basically maintain and progress through that month, the month of the Quran, the month by virtue of which you were asked to fast for one reason and one reason only. And that reason is that it is the month in which the Quran was revealed in. And that's why we were asked to fast in that month. The whole purpose, the whole corpus behind that particular issue of fasting is related to the question of the Quran. Why I say this? Why do I raise this particular point in that regard? If we look at any creation or manufacturing or at anything that is made by people, normally when you want to produce an item, you first think about the idea. You think about what you want to make. You think about what is it that you desire the outcome to be. So what do? You put that plan in place. You put that idea in writing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need that, but in order to teach us, He actually alluded to that when He said that before I put you on the face of this earth, I need to give you a blueprint. That blueprint is what? Is the Quran. Why? Because you are a human being by principle, not by material. You're a human being by principles and values, not by your material worth. So Allah says what? Ar-Rahmanu allama al-Quran. Not khalaqa al-insan, allama al-Quran. Then what? Khalaqa al-insan. So the purpose of your creation is what? To teach you the Quran. Subhanallah. Ar-Rahman allama al-Quran khalaqa al-insan allamahu al-bayan. So the purpose of your creation is to learn, is to be able to encompass others within your life. Ramadan as a month of spiritual perfection comes in order to achieve that pre-plan that was put by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He said in Surah Al-Rahman, الرحمن علم القرآن. Here I want to take your attention to that particular also verse of the Quran. الرحمن علم القرآن. When you want to teach, be merciful. Don't be tough. Don't be harsh. Don't be offensive. Don't drive people from this religion. Don't allow yourself to assume a position where people lose their faith on account of your approach. Why? Because Allah says He is the merciful. By virtue of being merciful, He taught. Subhanallah. By virtue of being merciful, He taught. If you're a teacher, if you're an alim, if you're a master of any trade, draw crowd towards you by your mercy. And tonight, since it is the first night of Ramadan, right? We want to do something and make a declaration. Why I say we need to do that? Because in the prophetic tradition, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says what? Rasulullah says that this month, the beginning of it, is what? Is rahmah. The middle of it is what? Maghfirah. The end of it is emancipation from hellfire. Subhanallah. The beginning is mercy. The middle of it is forgiveness. The end of the month is total emancipation from hellfire. Now, if I am approaching that month where Allah says to me, the beginning of it is rahmah, then I cannot enter this month with hatred towards others. Right? I must enter this month with rahmah. I must enter this month with mercy. I must enter this month with forgiveness. So the declaration we need to make is what? We need to make bara'atu dhimma. We need to waive our rights over our brothers or sisters who may have, in one way or another, hurt us, spoke about us, slandered us. I'm not going to touch money because that's difficult. All right? Don't forgive them for your money. Ask for your haq in a rightful way. But in the ailments and the sickness of the heart, there are people who are waiting for your forgiveness today in the graves. Because they may have wronged you or wronged me, right? They may have overstepped their limits with you and me, and they wait for this month so that we can declare before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet and the Imam salawatullah wa salamu alayhim ajma'een. That Ya Allah, I make you bear witness with me today or upon me today that I waive my right over those who have slandered me, over those who have backbite me, over those who've spoken about me, over those who overstepped their limits with me. If you agree, give the loudest salawat on Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. So now we can safely enter the month. Now we can safely enter the month and say, Ya Allah, bestow your rahmah on us. Why? Because I have exercised my mercy towards those who overstepped me. So exercise yours towards me. Right? So exercise yours towards me, Ya Allah, because I'm so much in need of that mercy that you have given me. This is what we need to explore over the next 15, you know, nights. I want to explore the Quran. The Quran, which is the principle and the first source of legislation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. So that if we want to stipulate a law, the first reference point we go towards is what? Is the Quran. Don't forget the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who stated unequivocally, إِنِّي تَارِكُمْ فِيكُمُ الثَّقَلَيْنِ أَوْ الثِّقْلَيْنِ كتاب الله وعترتي أهل بيتي. Right? I'm leaving behind the two weighty things, the two heavy things. The first one is what? Is the Quran. The second is Ahlul Bayt. They must be hand in hand. We cannot give value to one over another. We must acknowledge that the Quran is the first principle of everything we do, of everything we aspire to be, of everything that shapes and forms our lifestyle. Islam is not a religion. Don't make that mistake. I'm telling you now, I'm responsible for what I'm saying. Islam is not a religion. Islam is a way of life. It's everything about you. It's everything about how you think, how you behave, how you relate to people, how you reach out to people, how you can actually encompass others within your own life. You must have heard of a very grand Ayatollah who passed about 2 years ago. He's well known, Ayatollah Fadhil Lankarani. Very well known. Go visit his website. He has a post that he had put on his website before he passed away. He said, I have studied and taught Quran for 55 years. That's a legacy, right? That's a legacy. Inshallah, Allah makes us live, not just to live, but to serve. Not just to live. The value of a human being is not by numbers. Not by numbers. It's by what he can inspire people and the effect he leaves on the life of others that he had the opportunity to live with. Fatima al-Zahra, 18 years. Her impact and legacy is until now and until the day of judgment. Right? Imam Askari says what? In his famous hadith, نَحْنُ حُجَدُ اللَّهِ عَلَىٰ خَلْقِهِ. We are God's proof over all his creation, but أُمُّنَا الزَّهْرَىٰ حُجَّةُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْنَا. Subhanallah. But our mother Fatima is the hujjah of Allah on the imams. Ajib, this hadith, her legacy, her importance lies in what? Lies in what she gave to the world, what she taught the world, what she left behind in terms of heritage that he had taken from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. You know, all this I talk about is based on having one important aspect within ourselves. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a beautiful hadith, بعد الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد. He says, ألا إن في الجسد مضغ. Surely there is a morsel inside every human being. If that morsel, if that small body, right? He's referring to it as a small body, not in shape, not necessarily in shape so that we can, but he's used that word in order to relate to what he's saying. Surely there is a morsel in everyone's body that if that morsel becomes sound and perfect, then everything complies. They said, Ya Rasulullah, what is it? He said, the heart. The heart, your heart, your conscience, how you approach others, how you relate to Allah, how do you relate to your own self? Because you are not a small mass, in the words of Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Taz'umu. Taz'umu annaka jurmun saghir. You claim to be a small, minute mass, yet the whole secret of the universe has been embedded in you. No wonder why Ali ibn Abi Talib said, Man arafa nafsah faqad arafa rabbah. Right? You're not a small entity. If you know your inside and what you are made of, your disposition, what Allah has given within you and made you to be and planned for you to be, don't underestimate your worth. So we need to examine these hearts. The Quran mentions, brothers and sisters, 20 different types of hearts in the Quran. 20 different types. If you don't know these types of the Quran, you know, or these types of hearts in the Quran, then we have a problem. Because we need to start from the source. We need to begin with the source. And the source is what? Is none other than the Quran. Everything Ahlul Bayt Salamullah alayhim taught, everything Ahlul Bayt wanted to reflect on, everything Ahlul Bayt said was always, always measured against what? The Quran. They themselves said it in the most unambiguous terms. If you hear a statement on our behalf, or a narrative, or a hadith, a narration, or a saying, first and foremost, what should you do? Examine it against the Quran, right? See, does it conform to the Quran or does it not conform to the Quran? So if it does not conform to the Quran, what do you do with it? Hit it against the wall, they say. It's a strong term. It's a very strong term. It says, why? Because we have not said it. Subhanallah. We have not said it. You know, out of, you know, concern, not out of orders. I don't give orders. I don't have the means to give orders, but out of love and concern. You know, these gadgets that we have, iPhone, I don't know what, or X, I don't know what's going to happen after X, you know, maybe Y, Z, whatever, right? We receive sometimes posts, you know, Qala Rasulullah, forward, straight, Qala Rasulullah. Do you know what Rasulullah said? No, just forward. And the most amazing things and astonishing thing about these forwards is that they play on your conscience. They play on your emotions. Don't let it stop at you. It's like, you know, blackmail. Make sure you send it to all your contacts. So you go and send it to all your contacts. And the other one send it to his contact. You know who's benefiting from this? Vodafone. Right? Not you and me. Because the hadith actually is a lie to start with. Most of it has no basis. And those who has basis need to be verified. Right? Don't make yourself a tool just to forward matters. Make yourself a pioneer in what you read and what you teach others. That's how Rasulullah wants you to be. That's how the Imams want you to be. Salawatullah wa salamu alayhim ajma'in. If you examine the words of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullah wa salamu alayhim ajma'in, in reference to how they described what a proper Muslims ought to be and how a Muslim should be. And you know, when Ahlul Bayt talk about the term, in inverted commas, Shia, they're not actually referring to a sect. Don't make that mistake, brothers and sisters. When Ahlul Bayt talk about this particular reference, or they make reference to this word, they are saying this: if you do what we tell you, then you are a Shia, wherever you come from, right? You become a follower. That's the meaning of the word, right? You become a follower of Ahlul Bayt. So if you have these particular characteristics, prerequisites to what Ahlul Bayt teach, then you become what? Their followers. One of these statements that we have at hand is a very interesting wasiyah that was given by Imam al-Baqir in an exchange, in a dialogue between him and a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who lived and outlived many of the companions of the Prophet, by the name of Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. And the Prophet even told Jabir, he said, "Oh Jabir, oh my companion, you will outlive me until you reach a time and an age where you will meet one of my children. His name is Muhammad al-Baqir. فَأَقْرِئْهُ مِنِّي السَّلَامِ. Greet him on my behalf. Say salam to him from your grandfather, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam." So this Jabir goes to the Imam once and he says to the Imam, "Teach me something about your teachings. Tell me something about what you have inherited and learned from your forefathers through the chain of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." Yet Jabir was a companion himself. But you know what? رَحِمَ امْرِئٍ عَرَفَ قَدْرَ نَفْسَهُ. May Allah have a mercy on everyone that knows his limits. How beautiful is this statement? If only we know our limits and we stop at our limits and don't transgress our limits, you know, the world the world will move in the right direction. But when everyone assumes the position of something that he's not well versed with, or he is not able to have knowledge about this item, you know, I'm not against people learning any knowledge, right? And when I say I don't have any problem with people learning any knowledge, it is in order that we know what is right and what is wrong. You know, Islam never put a ban on anything. Never put a ban on someone. Never put a ban on a book. No. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, read. But read in which form and in whose name? Read for fame? No. Read for self, you know, eminence? No. Read so people would say, MashaAllah, Nari Haydari? No. Read so that you can gain the pleasure of Allah. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Read in the name of thy Lord. Because if you read in the name of thy Lord or your Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will never go against his instructions. Because you are reading in his name. So read to be an engineer. But don't put something that is not in conformity with your profession. Why? Because your conscience must be with Allah, not with the check that you get under the table. Read to be a doctor, but don't kill human life. Why? Because you read in the name of Allah. And Allah says, وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَقَدْ أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. The one who gives life to one soul, it is as if he revived the entire human race. Read in the name of your Lord, even if you are a council worker. Why? Because your responsibility is not to the council. Your responsibility is to Allah who is overseeing your work. Read in the name of Allah, whoever or whatever profession you are in, so that you can always be conscious to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have an enlivened heart. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. When on that day, no money and no children, progeny, will be of any use to you or benefit, except those who come to Allah with what? With a sound heart. What is a sound heart? Something that doesn't have bypass? No, have a million bypass, right? Have an open heart surgery. Allah is not talking about that heart that is, you know, has a problem with it in terms of veins and chambers and whatever. No, Allah is talking about a heart that is corrupt, right? A heart that has malice, a heart that has hatred, a heart that gives itself the right to dictate who goes to Jannah and who goes to Nar. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran speak to his beloved prophet, where there is no creation on the face of this earth higher in status than that of Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Right? When he speaks to the prophet, what does he say to him? He says, lasta alayhim bimusaytir. You have no authority over them. Then what is your job, ya Rasulullah? Huh? What is my job? What is the job of all my colleagues? Alims, mushtahid, maraja of taqleed, you name it. What is it? It's just to call people. Just to show people. It's up to them. Whether they want to believe, not believe, don't pass judgment. Huh? Our youth are being confused when they read the Quran and the purity of the teachings of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhim ajma'een, and they find that these kind of people were never judgmental. Then they come into a community and they find, whoa, we are all over the place, right? Of course, I'm not talking about Dar al-Salam Jama'at, you know? I haven't even started. It's my first night, right? And I have no right to speak anyway, right? All I'm saying is that we should not allow discrepancy to take place within what we teach and what we do. Because Islam, as I said, is not a religion. It's a way of life. It is not based on lip service. It is based on action. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَقُلْ اعْمَلُوا. Work. Do action. Because the witness on what you do is who? Allah, the Prophet, and the believers. Subhanallah. The believers become inspired by what you do. So look to the wordings of Al-Imam Al-Baqir, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi ba'da salat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. He said, O Jabir, do you think it is suffice, it is enough for someone to say, I love Ahlul Bayt and I am a follower of Ahlul Bayt, yet by God, these followers have certain prerequisites. So it's not good enough to say, I love Ahlul Bayt. Right from the start, right? Right from the start. That's my problem. I get excited, right? Not at you. I'm not shouting at you, you know? I just want to hear myself, right? So he says, there are certain prerequisites. So Jabir says, what are they? The Imam says, by God, those who claim our love are firstly very conscious of Allah. Allah is always in front of them. Just like Rasulullah said, worship Allah as if you can see him. And since you cannot see him, then make sure you have the belief system and the aqeedah and the thought and the methodology that he is seeing you. Whatever you do, wherever you are, he's observing your action. Those who have taqwa of Allah and obedience, so they have obedience of Allah, and they were known among their peers, yani wherever they exist, they are known by the following qualities. Humbleness. They're humble before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the people. And then what takhashu, and they have an awe within their presence before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they remember Allah much. Wa kathratu dhikrillah wa sawm, fasting, right? Wa salah, and prayers. And then he says, this is the bombshell. This is what we don't want to hear. Wa ta'ahud lil jiran. And they always look after their neighbors. Now, jiran, in this particular context, in the Arabic literature, in the Arabic linguistic terms, and in sarf and na'u and qawa'id, of course, I can't speak in front of giants. There are giants in Arabic language, I know, who are among us here. Though I'm an Arab, but doesn't matter. Who cares, right? Arabic is very specific. There is a term in Arabic called nakira. Nakira in English means generic. It's not specific. Jiran here is in that form. It's generic, not specific. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, our followers are always caring for their neighbors, it's not Muslim neighbors. It's anyone who's a neighbor. Anyone. Anything he may be, from any walk of life, this kills judgmental approach, right? It kills your judgmental approach. You don't say, he's a Jew, man. So what? He's a human being. He's a Christian. He's a human being. He's a Hindu. He's a human being. He's a Sikh. He's a human being. Right? He's a Sabian. He's a human being. Before anything, there's one common denominator between us and everyone else, and that is our humanity. And I've always said that. If you want a synonym term to Muslim, I will tell you what it is. It's human. It's to learn how to be human. When you learn how to be human, you become a submitter. And when you are a submitter, you are within the folds of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you will be receptive to the teachings of Allah and to the instructions of Allah, because you have no hatred in your heart. And even if you don't like someone, look at this concept from a purely Islamic point of view, but a juristic point of view, by the way. يعني مسألة فقهية. It's a fiqhi issue. Let's say I don't like someone. Why? Do I have the right? Yeah, because these are emotions, right? But emotions has to be what? Has to be in conformity with the law of Allah. They don't go above the law of Allah, right? Even when it is an emotional outburst or an emotional feeling. When I don't like someone, I have no right to usurp him of his right. If I don't like someone, I cannot deny him a good quality. If I don't like someone, I cannot take his right away to existence, to respect, to value, to presence, to sharing, to common issues of interest, because he's a human being, he has a right. He has a right. Look at what Allah says. I'm not talking from my own pockets. I'm talking from the Quran, because I said these 15 nights we want to live with the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ. وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ means what in Arabic? وَلَا يَحْمِلَنَّكُمْ يعني. Do not allow yourselves to be prone towards what? وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ عَلَىٰ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا. اِعْدِلُوا هُوَ أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى. Do not allow the animosity of people towards you. If someone doesn't like you, right? And he tells you, I don't like you, right? Allah is saying this in the Quran. He says, if you know a group of people or an individual that says to you, I don't see eye to eye with you, you know? Allah says what? If this happens or you have that feeling towards that person, do not allow that feeling to what? Not to remain in a state of justice towards that person. No, you deal with him on the basis of justice. This takes me to an incident in passing, I say it. How we can be inspired in action by the words of Amir al-Mu'mineen. There was a person during the time of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, in Kufa, when Imam moved to Kufa. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Tell me the time. His name is Al-Ash'ath ibn Qais. If I want to rate him from 1 to 10 in terms of hatred, he will be 10. That's how much he hated Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wasalam. Open animosity to Ali ibn Abi Talib. In fact, history tells us what? When Amir al-Mu'mineen used to go on the pulpit, on the minbar, in Masjid al-Kufa, he used to go and bring a lectern or a minbar outside the masjid, and he would speak against Ali ibn Abi Talib. Amir al-Mu'mineen, the head of the state, is giving his speech. Imagine someone is addressing the nation. Friday prayer is what? An address to the nation, right? At that time, Amir al-Mu'mineen was the governor of at least 28 different states. Yani he's a leader of 28 different countries, right? In today's standard, he's giving his khutbah from the minbar. Ash'ath ibn Qais is giving a what? A counter khutbah. So the friends and the companions of Amir al-Mu'mineen goes to Amir al-Mu'mineen after the khutbah, says, ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, he's at it again. Yani it's not the first time. Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, he's at it again, this son of a gun. Right? He's saying things about you. Should we stop him? He said, leave him for as long as he is not interfering in state security. If it's against me personally, let him vent. Ajeeb. Ajeeb. Let someone speak about me. You know, I'll choke him with my turban. Why? Because I think I have an authority over him. I'm a sheikh. Big deal. Big deal. Right? You don't have an authority over people. Right? So he speaks against him. Look, it doesn't end here. Allahu Akbar, how beautiful Ahlul Bayt are. You know why? Because they principled themselves with the Quran. They are the children of the Quran. They are the heirs of the Quran. They are the representation of the Quran. Ali ibn Abi Talib himself says, this is the silent Quran and I am the spoken Quran. Right? He says to his companions, when the fay' used to come. You know what fay'? Fay' means, you know, the money, zakat, jizya, khums, whatever that used to come into the Muslim revenue state. He divides the Muslim revenue. This poor person, this guy has this entitlement. He said, and this is for Al-Ash'ath ibn Qais. Huh? What is this, Ya Amir? Ash'ath ibn Qais. The one who's criticizing you and talking about you. He said, وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ عَلَىٰ أَنْ لَا تَعْدِلُوا. He says, don't allow the animosity of people to cause you to be unjust. He is one of the subjects of my state. And he has a right to Muslim money. Ajeeb. Ajeeb. This is standards. This is value. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we've brought the system first and then we created you. عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ so that you can know that your purpose is within the folds of that Qur'an. So, I mean, he continues, Imam al-Baqir, he said, and they always look after their neighbors. من الفقراء وأهل المسكنة. They always go towards their neighbors and look after them. Among the poor and those who are deprived. والغارمين. Who are the غارمين? The ones who had fallen under debt. Genuine. Because a Muslim is not a fool. المؤمن كيس قطن. فطن. المؤمن كيس فطن. ليس بكيس قطن. Right? A mu'min is clever and very aware. He's not a sack of cotton. Because if you change the dots on these two words, it turns to be a bag of cotton. Right? So this كيس can read كيس. Or فطن can be read قطن. So a mu'min is aware, alert. He knows he's not fooled by someone. But if someone genuinely fell under debt, you should go to his rescue if you are able to do so. These are the qualities. والأيتام and the orphans. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. When it comes to orphans, we all have a soft spot, right? But there are others that need our help as well. Then he says, Imam al-Baqir, he said, this is very beautiful. وصدق الحديث. When they speak the truth. You know, that's a quality of the followers of Ahlul Bayt. وَكَانُوا Allah, Allah. Look at this. وَكَانُوا أُمَنَاءَ عَشَائِرِهِمْ فِي الْأَشْيَاءِ And they are known to be leaders in everything among their people. Whatever, whenever they are best at anything they do. Or they try to be leaders in anything they do. Pioneers. You know, our forefathers were pioneers. They left us with that setup. They left us with the legacy that one among them one day wakes up in the morning and says, this building is fi sabilillah. Right? Right? And we inherited this. Right? We inherited this. We must continue that heritage. We cannot become stagnant. We need to continue the legacy of our forefathers. And these people who need to take over from our forefathers are not the elders. May Allah, you know, honor them and grant them long life, you know. It is those who are youth. Why? Because the youth now represent half of our present and all of our future. If we lose them, that means we would have lost half of our present and all of our future. And that is something we cannot afford. We cannot afford to see our youth going away from us. And there are signs that are, and alarm bells that are happening within our communities. And when I say communities, I'm talking about Muslims worldwide that indicate we are losing grip over our youth. And we need to reconnect with them and make them connect with us and put them in places of leadership, or at least train them to assume places of leadership. That is not to oust anyone. I'm not running an election campaign here. Right? Not interested in politics at all. Never been interested in politics. But you know what? Amir al-Mu'mineen has a beautiful saying. Indirectly he says that. But this is the best way I can put it for. He said, a true believer and follower of Ahlul Bayt is someone who's always aware about the politics of his time. You cannot shun yourself away from community. You cannot sit at home and say, I've got nothing to do with it. We are all responsible, brothers and sisters. We have a responsibility towards this community and this Islam and this faith and these teachings of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullah wa salamu alayhim ajma'in. And there are leaders in whatever they do. Now, look at the shocking reply by Jabir. He said, Ya ibn Rasulullah, ma na'rifu ahadan bihadihi sifat. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah al-aliyy al-azim. Jabir says to Imam al-Baqir says, we don't know anyone who has these characteristics. Whoa. The Prophet has been dead how many years? From Rasulullah, 11 Hijrah, to Imam al-Baqir, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, 100 years? 120 years?
Jabir says, we don't know anyone with these characteristics. Ajib. Look what the Imam then says to him. He says, Ya Jabir, لا تذهبن بك المذاهب. Don't let your thoughts go far. Don't allow someone to tell you, I love Rasulullah, and he does not follow his sunnah. For Rasulullah is better than Ali. And the one who claims his love to Rasulullah, yet he does not follow him, his claim is false. His claim is false. So for someone to come and say, I love Ali ibn Abi Talib, yet he does not pursue the path of Ali ibn Abi Talib, then he is not following the sunnah of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. And then his love means nothing on the day of judgment. Ajeeb. Allahu Akbar. He says, your love alone without action and pursuing the path of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullah wa salamu alayhim ajma'een, will not get you to our intercession on the day of judgment. We will intercede for you when you do your level best. And then you sleep here or there. Or you sleep here and there. Then we'll come. Yeah, we'll jump on the, you know, and we'll come to your rescue. We will come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll say before Allah, Ya Allah, by our virtue, by our right, by our stand, by our position, this man was a true lover. He really tried his level best. She really tried her level best. But as a human being, she slipped. Ya Rasulullah, Ya Allah. He slipped, Ya Allah. Make us his intercessors on the day of judgment. Allah says, granted. Granted, because you are worth it, because I'm worth it, because we did our level best. But just to offer lip service, just to say, I am the follower of Ali ibn Abi Talib or Ahlul Bayt, and then I don't follow them? No. Look what he then says. أحب العباد إلى الله وأكرمهم عليه أتقاهم. The closest to Allah and the most honored in the sight of Allah are those who possess the best God consciousness. The best God consciousness. And then what? وَأَكْرَمُهُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَتْقَاهُمْ لَهُ وَأَعْمَلَهُمْ بِطَاعَتِهِ. And the one who really seriously do what? Obey his commands. And follow what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them. وَمَا يُتَقَرَّبْ إِلَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ إِلَّا بِالطَّاعَةِ. And you can never ever come closer to Allah with any mean other than acts of obedience. This is the shortest way to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Jabir, ma ma'ana bara'atan minan nar, wala ala Allahi li ahadin min hujja. He says, oh Jabir, don't go far with your thoughts. We do not have any, what? Any bara'ah, any emancipation from hellfire to anyone. That's in Allah's hand, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the one that he knows who's going there or not. And then he says, وَمَا عَلَى اللَّهِ لِأَحَدٍ مِّنْ حُجَّةٍ. And no one has anything against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except مَنْ كَانَ لِلَّهِ مُطِيعًا فَهُوَ لَنَا وَلِيٌّ. Whosoever is within the obedience of Allah, he's our wali. He is one of our followers. He is the one who gave his true oath of allegiance to our way. وَمَنْ كَانَ لِلَّهِ عَاصِيًا فَهُوَ لَنَا عَدُوٌّ. And whosoever disobeys Allah has declared himself an enemy of Ahlul Bayt. These are the words of Imam Al-Baqir, not my words, brothers and sisters. We need to examine these words in light of what? Of this holy month. In light of the concepts of the hearts of the Quran, the hearts in the Quran, in light of this book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. وَلَا يُنَالُ غَدًا وَلَا يَتُنَا. And no one can get our allegiance on the day of judgment except those who exercise wara'. Allahu Akbar. Those who have true, transparent consciousness of Allah. And wara is a level higher than taqwa, by the way. You know, higher than taqwa. Yani, Ahlul Bayt expect you that to exercise that fine sense of reform to such an extent that you must always ask yourself on a daily basis, Write to yourself a letter and say to yourself, these are my shortcomings. These are my defects. Today is the first night of Ramadan, right? Write a list of things and examine that list at the end of Ramadan. At the end of Mahi Ramadan or the month of Ramadan. See, has there been any change with me? Have I really made an attempt from the first day of Ramadan to the last day of Ramadan to change myself to the better? If not, you know the answer comes not from me, from Rasulullah. رُبَّ صَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُوعُ وَالْعَطَشِ. Perhaps there is someone who's observing fast, yet he gets nothing out of his fast except hunger and thirst. And do you think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really wants you to be thirsty and hungry? Yani Allah doesn't have anything else to do except to see you hungry and thirsty? Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a plan higher than just thirst and hunger? You know, your existence is based on two things. One, to preserve yourself, and one is to preserve your kind. Yani your humankind as a human being. These two things Allah has instilled within you. One is the need for food, and one is the need for intimacy. Because without intimacy, there is no continuation of the human race, right? And without food, there is an annihilation of your own self, right? Yet, anything that goes beyond that does not become a necessity anymore. It becomes a desire. Subhanallah. When you go above your need of food intake or intimacy, becomes what? It becomes a desire. It's not a necessity anymore. Right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribes this month in order that we can learn what is a necessity and what is a desire. Why I say this? Because it's very clear. When we refrain in the month of Ramadan, we are refraining from halal or haram. From what? Halal. Halal. Right? We don't eat, yet eating is what? It's halal. We don't drink. Drinking is what? Drink as in drink, huh? Yeah, as in normal drink. Huh? As when we drink water or juice or madafu, whatever the case may be. Right? This is the kind of drink we're talking about. We are refraining from halal. When we refrain from intimacy, with who? Halal or haram? With my missus. Not with the neighbors. Huh? With my missus, with my wife. I refrain myself from having intimacy with my wife or the wife with her husband, right? This is all halal. Yet for the whole duration of 30 days, during the day, I am able to refrain from what halal is. Allah says, then you are better be able after the month to refrain from what is haram. Right? It's better for you to learn that after the month goes, after the month exits, now you have trained yourself how to have the power and the ability to refrain from what is haram. That's how you sustain yourself. That's how you maintain yourself. That's how you become an integrity of a human being. That's how you become a principled human being. That's how you become a person with values that Allah had intended for you by putting the Quran first before creating you. Ar-Rahmanu 'allama al-Quran. Then what? Then khalaqa al-insan. He did not khalaqa al-insan and then he taught him the Quran. No. Allah is alluding to the fact that I want you to know what principles are. I want you to know what values are. And those values, by the way, those values that the Quran talks about in the Quran, or Allah talks about in the Quran, tell me in all honesty, with your hand on your heart, can you say that these principles in the Quran are Muslim principles or universal principles? Huh? Are they universal principles or Muslim principles? They are universal. They are here to serve the entire humankind. You go out here in the streets or in the West, you ask Johnny, Elizabeth, Tamara, you know, I don't know what. Tell her, what do you think about being fair to others? She's saying, yes, I'm with you. Absolutely. Of course. Justice, 100%. Equality, 100%. Not to discriminate, 100%. You know, not to have judgmental attitude towards others, 100%. This is Quran. This is what the Quran talks about. There are universal values, right? There are values that should touch the life of every single human being that lives on the face of this earth. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the messengers. That's why Allah sent the messengers. That's why Allah sent the imams, the awsiya, the ulama, the holy personalities, the saints, the sages. So what? So that we can effectuate God's principles in our day-to-day transactions, in our day-to-day life, so that when you go out of the mosque, you are the same person outside the mosque as you are inside the mosque. Right? And, you know, there is a saying in Arabic, it's common, it's universal saying. It says, treat people as they treat you. You know, this is the most dangerous saying and proverb in the world. Why? Because if you want to treat people the way they treat you, people are liars. Some of them. Hypocrites. You know, cheaters. Deceivers. So in order to treat them the way they treat you, you have to have all these qualities. So you become the worst human being on the face of earth. Right? So what is an alternative to that? Treat people the way you like people to treat you. Right? And there is a better one than that, higher than that. You know? Treat people the way Allah expects you to treat them. Allahu Akbar. Treat people the way Allah expects you to treat them. And there is even a higher concept. Treat people on the basis that you treat them as you would like Allah to treat you. Allahu Akbar. Treat people as you expect Allah to treat you. What do you become then? You become higher than the malaika. Right? You become higher than the angels. You hold the reign of your nafs, of your soul, of your inside, in such a manner that no one can influence you. And that's what we want to teach our youngsters. We want our youngsters not to buckle at every challenge that comes their way. No, we want to build their aqidah on solid grounds, on solid foundation, that when someone challenges them about their faith, they don't call Sheikh to the rescue. Or a Sayyid to the rescue. No, you have the answer. And you don't have the answer to win the debate. You have the answer to win the heart. Right? Because you may win the debate easily, but if you lose the heart of someone, you've lost everything. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he spoke to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I conclude, what did he say to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, Ya Rasulullah, I've sent you with a mission. I've sent you with principles. I've sent you with values. These people may not relate to you well because these values are still fresh and foreign to them. So how do you approach them? You approach them with the best of mannerism, right? Because we gave you the best of mannerism. Huh? So, Ya Rasulallah, wajadilhum billati hiya ahsan. When you debate with them, when you discuss with them with the most immaculate and beautiful terms. Why? So that you can soften their hearts. When Allah sent Musa and Harun to Fir'aun, there was no tyrant as the tyranny of Fir'aun, right? But what did Allah say to Musa and Harun? وَقُولَا لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. And speak to him softly. لَعَلَّهُ يَخْشَعُ. Perhaps he may have that inclination in his heart to become soft. To soften his heart. To soften his heart. You want to teach people Islam? Don't teach it with words. Wallah. Wallah. Don't teach it with words. Do what you do with actions. Be a pillar, a lantern of huda and taqwa. Be a lantern of guidance. وَكَانُوا أُمَنَاءَ فِي عَشَائِرِهِمْ. Imam al-Baqir says they were leaders, pioneers in their people, in the way they approach things, and they, you know, reach out to others. With this, I conclude. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين. Inshallah, we will continue every night with two
only two types of hearts, because I have 20 and I only have 15 days with you. So I'll try to cover all the 20 types of hearts within the Quran with a brief description, and we can venture out from that discussion into current, you know, situations and issues that are facing us as a community, whether it is here or worldwide. Today, our problems are common and they are universal. So wherever you are in the world, you have similar problems and similar issues, and we need to talk about these issues. We cannot just think about them. We need to talk about them and find solution for them. Not only talk about them, because we've been talking about them for so long. We need to provide a system of change, and that system of change cannot come just from lectures. It comes from a will and a commitment and a drive from within towards change. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمُ وَبَارَكَ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ الطَّيِّبِينَ الطَّاهِرِينَ.